Pero ang isang mas exciting na topic ay yung sa negotiable instrument. Maiksi lang tayo ron. I will not hold you here until 5 o'clock, but I will have a break at 3 o'clock. For you to answer negotiable instruments law questions, you must have a perspective of what negotiable instruments is. Why? Because your test will be conceptual. It will not be objective. They will not even probably make a repeat of the 2005 bar exams, where there were questions as what are the characteristics of a negotiable instrument? What are the purposes of a negotiable instrument? What are the features of a negotiable instrument? No, this will be a case problem. And we were promised case problems. Perhaps the only objective will be number one. From looking at the word negotiable instruments itself, you will already know what it means. Let's have a perspective on this. The main word is instruments. There are many forms of instruments in the world. Musical instruments, war instruments. But we're not talking about all instruments. Ours is a specific negotiable. This is the main word. Oh, you already took this up under Dean Sun Jiang. My presentation is just quite different, okay? Okay, Dean Sun Jiang, it's for intellectuals. Mine is pangmasa. Okay. Negotiable is just an adjective here. This is not a noun. That is the noun. And this is an adjective because it describes a noun. Remember adjective? Word which describes a noun or a pronoun. Oh, I learned that in grade 3. When was that? Oh, you were not imagined by your parents. But I can tell you when I was in grade 3. I was grade 3 in 1959. God, don't look at me as ancient, okay? Now, yeah, I told you, I'm 60 years old now. Look. But look at this. This is civil law in character. This is commercial law. A negotiable instrument is a combination of commercial and civil law, but the base is civil law. Instrument. When you look at the word instrument, what do you mean? Behind it is an agreement or technically a contract. Because an instrument is simply the tangible evidence of a contract. A contract needs a tangible evidence for purposes of evidences or proof. But can there be a contract without an instrument? Yes. You have just studied civil law. Can there be a contract without an instrument? Instrument? Yes. Can there be a contract without a deed? Yes. Can there be a contract without a writing? Yes. Simple, sir. How do you know it? A contract is not defined as a writing. I don't know if I still remember my civil code, but this is what I remember. A contract is a meeting of the minds, whereby one party with respect to the other binds himself to render some service. See that? A meeting of the minds. It did not say a contract is an instrument. A contract is a writing. A contract is a deed. No, baby. It's a meeting of the minds. Salubungan ng dalawang isipan. Pag merong konting emotional ka, umpuga ng dalawang diwa. Yan ang contract. May problema nga lang kung walang instrument. Pag tinanggi niya na may usapan, mahirap patunayan. Kaya may instrument as an evidence of the meeting of the mind. So therefore, a contract is not the instrument and the instrument is not the contract. So there can be a contract without an instrument. Go back to your law on sales. I am sorry to go back to civil law because negotiable instruments is civil law. Remember article 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, earnest money? 1483. Okay. Because earnest money is 1482. Why are you smiling? Oh, 1482 is earnest money. If you have the civil code, 1324 is option money. See those? 1483. A contract of sale, maybe in writing or by word of mouth, or partly in writing or partly by word of mouth, or it may be inferred from the conduct of the parties. That's your civil code. That's 1483. Look at the words, by word of mouth. Hindi na lang sinabing oral, but meron bang by word of nose, by word of ears, by word of eyes, by word of mouth. Yung mga lumang English ng ating mga ninuno na sa batas, no? See? That is the same provision which supports 1475 of your law on sales, that a contract of sale is perfected by mere agreement of the parties. What does your 1356 say of your obligations and contracts? A contract is obligatory in whatever form it may be, as long as it has a consent, object, and cause. Okay, however, the theory will change when you add the word negotiable before instrument. If there is no negotiable, the instrument is not the contract, the contract is not the instrument. But when you add the word negotiable, the contract is the instrument is the contract. There is no more distinction. That's the defier, you're silent. The word negotiable here has nothing to do with the validity of the contract. I have seen answers saying, the contract is not negotiable, hence not valid. Santa Maria ang kanano. Negotiability has nothing to do with validity of the contract. Negotiability is only the mode of transfer of a contract. The mode of transfer. When the instrument has the characteristics of Section 1, you transfer it by negotiation. If it does not have the characteristics, it is valid, but you transfer it by assignment. See, there is no holder in an assignment. The word holder exists only in a negotiable instrument. What are you called if not negotiable? Assignee, assignor. Yung isa, holder. What do you hold? The instrument. What instrument? Negotiable instrument. How do you hold the instrument? Tightly or gently, depending upon the blowing of the wind. Do not try that. In negotiable instruments, most questions are found, even in problems, in the most basic parts. Baka naman inaaksayan yung oras nyo studying acceptance supra protest, payment supra protest, acceptance for honor, daan yan na lang. Payment for honor, daanan nyo na lang. Pero huwag kayong magpangamatay doon. Kasi sa mga basics nagtatanong sa problems, for instance, sa features of a negotiable instrument. Features. Hindi ko sinasabing requisites. Features. Anong unang feature? Negotiability. Is it not? Siyempre, dahil negotiable. Ay yung pangalawa, accumulation of secondary contracts. Oh, pwede bang magamit yon sa problem? Yes, sa forgery. Basic yan. Oh, let me give you an example. Oh, haba naman ito. Look. Okay, we are having a promissory note. Who is the origin of a promissory note? A maker. Why is he called the maker? He makes. What does he make? A promise to pay. See? In a bill of exchange. Who makes a bill of exchange? No one makes a bill of exchange. Someone draws. The drawer is not a maker because he does not make a promise. He tells you to draw money from someone else. Ang drawer sa bill of exchange at check ay wise. He asks somebody to pay the payee. In a promissory note, he says, I promise to pay. He is primarily liable. In a bill of exchange, he designates a drawer. He says, hoy, bayaran mo siya to his order or to bearer. Biro mo, hindi siya ang nangangako. Yung iba inuutusan. See, that's a bill of exchange. That's a check. Oh, magbabayad ba siya? Hindi. Kailangan mag-accept muna siya. Kasi, you can designate anyone to pay. Kailangan pumayag siya. Pag pumayag siya, hindi na siya drawee. Acceptor na. The acceptor now is primarily liable because now, it is as if he promises to pay by accepting the order. Oh, you get the story? Oh, you see how easy this one is? Easy, kasi dito pa lang tayo. Maker. Okay. He issues it to the order of P. Okay? Order. Then he negotiates it to A. Okay? Marami ditong theories sa law na hindi ginagamit sa pang-araw-araw na buhay. Okay? Ito, nagagamit yan sa pagbili ng kotse. Installment basis. May promissory note ka to pay the balance. Eh. Okay. Dito na tayo kay C. Si C is the holder. What does he hold? The instrument. How? Gently. Okay. Because it will be crumpled. There might be spoliation. Okay. Now, look at this. When we talk about the characteristic of accumulation of secondary contract, the moment M issues it and delivers to P, that's the first contract. When he negotiates it to A, that's the second contract. This time, there are parties to the contract, A, P, and M. When he negotiates it to C, there are no parties to the contract, M, P, A, and C. They are joined under the privity of contract because of the accumulation of secondary contracts. Look at this. Suppose at this point, there was a forgery of the endorsement of A. He is innocent of the forgery. He accepted the instrument and it came to his hands, complete and regular upon his face. See? He has no knowledge of any fact, let's say, which would impair the validity of the instrument, let's say, blah, 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 or defect in the title of the person negotiating it. He received it in good faith and for value. And he had no notice of any notice of dishonor if such was the fact. Therefore, he is what? The holder in due course under Section 52. So, in other words, ang kanyang puso ay wagas at dalis. Bumunta siya kay C para maningil. Itong accumulation of secondary contract. Magbabayad na sana si M. Nung nilipad ang note, nakita niya, oh, kilala ko si A. Hindi ito ang kanyang signature. Forged to. Sabi ni C, eh, bakit hindi ka magbabayad, M? Hindi naman si A ang sinisingil ko eh. Ikaw eh. Ang signature mo, valid eh. Oh. Ba't hindi ka magbabayad? At ako'y holder in due course. Innocent ako. Tingnan niyo ako. At meron pa akong halo over my head. Oh. Medyo ginto-ginto pa yan ng konti. Oh. Look, pwede bang makasingil si C kay M? Yan. Yan ang sinasabi ko. Yung basic magagamit mo sa pagsagot ng mga tanong sa forgery. Tandaan niyo yung sitwasyon na ganyan, kung komplikado ang tanong, merong forgery sa gitna. See, hindi mo kailang magbasa ng cases. Yan basic. Hindi siya makakasya. Dagdagan na lang natin D para marami sila, okay? Oh. Forge, C, Innocent yan, innocent yan. Okay, Holder and Juco. Hindi yan pwedeng pagbayarin kay D. Why? Civil law. There is no more privity of contract between D and M. Because when there was a forgery here, the contractual relation was cut off by the forgery. That's why you have heard the doctrine in Din Son Jiang talking about prior parties. A, whose signature is forged, is surely not liable. But these persons before him are also not liable. They are parties prior to the forgery. Why are they not liable? Because there is no more privity of contract between C, between D, and M, and P. It was cut off by the forgery. Nawala na yung accumulation of secondary contracts. Tumigil ang contract dito. Silang magkakontrata, sila naman ang magkakontrata na. Okay, ano nangyari? D goes to M. And M said, I refuse to pay. Hindi mo yan pwedeng pilitin. Because he's a prior party. Do you get my point? Okay. Pero anong gagawin ni D? A million yan. Ang una niyang gagawin, umiyak muna. A million eh. But then you are a law student, you approach him, you calm him down. Huwag kang mag-alala, iho, makakasingil ka. Bakit? Give him a notice of dishonor. And then he says, I am innocent. Aha, eh ano kung innocent ka? When you endorsed it to me, you warranted that the instrument is genuine and in all respects what it purports to be, you are liable under your warranties. Nakasingil. Anong gagawin niya? Di habulin niya ang forger. Pero ikaw makasingil. Pero hindi to makasingil dun. Dito. Kasi prior party sila. Dahil sa forgery, nawala ang koneksyon ng kontrata. Tumigil ang pagtulo ng tubig. Tumigil. Iba na ang tulo dito. Hindi sila kasama dun. So, that is a model for answering questions like those. Accumulation of secondary contract. Oh, there are many things. But look at this. How many times have I seen a question like, you know, they're very kindergartens, but the question, what are the purpose and functions of a negotiable instrument? Even if they are innocent looking, hindi mo pwedeng baliwalain yun. Ano nga yun? Substitute for money, isn't it? Oh, bumili ka ng isang kalabaw, sabi ng farmer, kulang ang pera mo, issue ka ng cheque. Oh, substitute for money yung cheque. It is also, it increases the purchasing medium, isn't it? Kasi hindi na lang pera ang medium of exchange, kundi pati cheque promissory note. Oh. It is also an evidence of the transaction. Pag nag-issue ka ng negotiable instrument, sa likod nun may transaction. So do not forget those little things. But even if it is a substitute for money, it is not legal tender. It's not legal tender. Even if it is a certified check. Even if it is a manager's check. Even if it is a cashier's check. They are not legal tender. Why? Because of Section 60 of the new Central Bank Act. What does Section 60 say? Checks, certified or whatever, have no legal tender power. This is the legal basis. No legal tender power. No Central Bank Act, NCBA. And the acceptance of a check is at the option of the creditor. By the way, on July 6, 2006, the Monetary Board released Circular Number 537, changing the legal tender amount of coins. The original legal tender of coins was in Section 52 of the new Central Bank Act. The old rule was this, 25 cents and above, not more than 50 pesos legal tender. Below it, not more than 20 pesos. Okay? So, hindi ka pwedeng piliting tumanggap noon ng sukli na mahigit 50 pesos na puro coins. Why? Bakit limitado ang pagiging legal tender ng coins? Kasi pwede yung gamitin pamerwisyo sa creditor. May utang ka 10 million sa banko. Sabi mo, eto na, magbabayad na ako on the due date. Nasaan? Ayun o, sa tatlong 6x6 puro coins. Bilangin mo. Kawawa naman ang teller. Baka may apo na siya, hindi pa siya tapos magbilang. Kaya napansin nyo, may mga machines tayo, lalo na sa casino, na ilalagay mo lang sa isang lalagyan. Wini-weigh na. Wini-weigh. Tapos lalabas na digital kung magkanong amount nun. Hindi ka na magbibilang ng coin. By weight na lang. By weight. Nahiram na lang yung style na yun sa Las Vegas. By weight. Ngayon, iba na. 1 peso above. Ano bang mga coins natin? 1 peso, 5 pesos, 10 pesos. Legal tender yun, up to 1,000. Pag below this, anong below 1 peso? 25 cents? Legal tender, up to 100 pesos. That's July 6, 2006. May power bang ganun ang Monetary Board? Oh yes. Sabi sa Section 52, eto ang mga legal tender amount ng coins. Unless the Monetary Board declares otherwise. Ooh. Dineclare nga ng July 6, 2006. O ngayon, may utang kang 2,000 sa akin. Andito ka ngayon, dala mo mamiso. Puro 1,000 mamiso. Alam mong circular eh. 1,000 mamiso, 2,000 ang utang mo. Ayokong tanggapin. Sabi mo, legal tender yan. Nag-define ka pa ng legal tender. Legal tender is that money which the creditor can compel the debtor to accept in payment of all obligations, whether private or public. Alam mo ba yan? Oh, kunin mo. Ayoko. Bakit? Hindi ka pwedeng pilitin. Because you cannot be compelled to accept incomplete payment. Civil Code. Anong provision? 1233. Payment is only deemed payment when complete. Kung partial, you have a justifiable ground to reject the payment. Okay. Ito si Sagisag, no, naalala ko. We were appearing in one case. He was in Sandigan Bayan. Na-contempt siya. Alam mo, dala? Mamera. Sa doon sa, ano, yung lalagyan ng tubig na ganyan ang korte. Andun ang lahat ng mamera. Halagang 3,000 daw yun. Eh, ang fine sa kanya ay 2,000. Direct contempt. Binabayad niya. Pero hindi naman halagang 2,000 yun dahil hindi puno eh, puro mamere. Kung ako sa court, pinagtsagaan kong bilangin, hindi ko tanggapin kung kulang. Tapos dagdag pa ng contempt for kalokohan. Eh, sisagisag talaga, maraming ano yan. Pero, pakabait na tao. Now, rebelde talaga yun, rebelde talaga, pati sa korte. Okay, look, kailangang makita ninyo ang negotiable instruments from a holistic perspective. Para maintindihan yung negotiable instruments, tingnan nyo from the point of view of the incidents in the life of a negotiable instrument. I-compare nyo yan sa Bill of Exchange and Check. Look at this, ha? Kailangang makita nyo to. Ganitong pag-aaral, hindi yung puro memorize ng concepts. Yan ang unang life issue. O, di alamin mo ngayon, ano bang ibig sabihin ng issue? The first delivery of an instrument complete in form to the person who takes it as a holder. Therefore, kung pinatatago ko lang sa'yo at yun ay payable to order, ay hindi yun issue kasi there is no intent to transfer title. He is not a holder in the legal sense. Anong tawag sa kanya? Tagahawak lang. Pero hindi holder in the legal sense. Okay. Ang susunod ay, ganito ba kayo mag-aral? Ganitong pag-aaral sa negotiation. Section 30 ka na. Ang tanong dyan, paano ka nagninegotiate? Depende. Payable to bearer, payable to order. Tingnan nyo yan. Ganyan ang pag-aaral. Tawag dyan ay holistic perspective. Bearer, how do you negotiate? By mere delivery. Order, there are two processes. Endorsement, completed by delivery. Ang dami nyo lang alam. Ay, paano ka, sir, mag-endorse? Di blank, special, restrictive, ano ba, qualified, at may dagdag ang American jurisprudence, facultative. Yan. Tingnan mo ngayon ang effects niyan. Ganyan ang pag-aaral ng nego, hindi yung isa-isa. Hindi lahat yan itatanong. Anong susunod niyan? Anong effect niyan? Ang effect niyan ay magiging holder ka. These are the acts to make you a holder. Kung meron mali sa negotiation, hindi ka holder. Halimbawa, payable to order. Dineliver lang sa'yo. Walang endorsement. Hindi ka holder. Assignee ka. Kung assignee ka, lahat ng depekto ng pinanggalingan, namana mo yan. Pero pag holder ka, may depekto siya, hindi mo mamanahin kung holder in due course ka. Yan ang epekto. Yan ang pangmasa. Walang memorization. Yan. Holder. Okay. Ang susunod na bahagi ng promissory note, diretso ka na, presentment for payment. Yan. Napansin nyo, ang promissory note, walang presentment for acceptance. Diretso ka sa presentment for payment. Anong gagawin mo on the maturity date of the note? Promissory note to, ha? Promissory note. Yeah. Saan ka pupunta? Hindi ka nagme-memorize, ha? Pero ang sunod na tanong ay liabilities of parties. Kanino ka pupunta for presentment for payment? You are not going to the party secondarily liable. You are going to the party primarily liable. The maker in a promissory note. Why is he primarily liable? He made the promise to pay. And how is he liable? He is liable according to the tenor of the instrument. Tenor of the instrument. If the instrument says 100, he's liable for 100. He says 50, he promises 50,000. He's liable for 50,000. That is section 60. Now, so, the holder says, Mr. Maker, I have an instrument. I am holding my instrument, Mr. Maker. Please look at it. I want you to pay my instrument. He says, your instrument is defective. I will not pay. I don't like it. There is a problem. There was a dishonor. There was a dishonor by non-payment. So if there is a dishonor by non-payment, what is the holder going to do? Instead of crying, and he knows the law, he should give a notice of dishonor to parties secondarily liable. Yeah, that's the story. But suppose it is paid. If it is, there is payment, and it is in due course, the instrument is discharged. Meaning, the liabilities under the instrument are extinguished. The obligations are extinguished. So from the issue of the instrument, beautiful words, the instrument is discharged. This is a promissory note. This is what you should study. But why has there been a dishonor by non-payment? There is no more space. You know what the reason is? I'll syncretize it here. Because of defenses, personal or real. See? There is a dishonor by non-payment because of the defenses available to him, which could either be a personal defense or a real defense. And that is where most bar exams come from in a case problem. Aside from sections 1. This is now the bar for promissory notes. Think about it. Maybe next year, the whiteboard will be there to hear. But you will not be here anymore. You'll take your oath. Mayabang din kayo, ha? Yeah, you'll take your oath. You don't have to come back. See that? But sir, suppose, sir, it is a bill of exchange. Do we follow the same process? Basically, yes, but with certain changes. Okay, let's try to erase this, okay? Kaya lang, I hope you can read the next one. It's similar to this. And we call that perspective. And I will tell you a new case in relation to this. When was it decided? September 26, 2008. Okay, now look. Look at this. Oh, you tell me, huh? We will have a break at 3 o'clock. Now, let me finish it. You tell me if it is 3:10. Okay. Now, look. To make it different, we will write here, presentment for acceptance. Yeah. Are you supposed to present a bill of exchange for acceptance? Not always. Only sometimes. Only when section 143 applies. This was discussed with you. Only. See? Now, maybe I am going to erase the first part, okay? It's the same. It's the same. Look at this. Yeah. I'll erase it so that I have room to write. And I am going to put this up. You only present a bill of exchange for acceptance when any of the conditions in section 143 will apply. You look into that because this is not really a lecture on negotiable instruments. This lecture is only to help you answer critical areas. So I hope by looking at this, you will have an idea of what this animal is. Okay, you already have an idea. I just want to reinforce. Okay, so the third is presentment for acceptance. Now, what are the possible things that will happen? Okay? It may be dishonored by non-acceptance. Why is it dishonored by non-acceptance? Well, because of defenses again. And those defenses may be real or personal. What is the other name for real defense? Legal defense. What is the other name for personal defense? Equitable defense. Yeah. What are you supposed to do if it is dishonored by non-acceptance? Look at this. Ask a question. Is it a foreign bill or is it a domestic bill? An inland bill? Oh, if it is a foreign bill, you have to file a protest. If it is an inland bill, you have to file a notice of dishonor. Yeah, you see that? That's how the story is. Now, suppose it is not dishonored. So the other step is it may be accepted. And how is it accepted? Oh, many ways. It might be actual. It might be constructive. It might be general. It might be qualified. I cannot discuss this one by one because I'm giving you only a perspective. That's how to study this. Watch out for this. It is actual when the drawee says accepted sign. But when upon looking at the bill, he destroys it. It's deemed accepted. Constructive acceptance, meaning symbolic. It is destructive but constructive acceptance. Or when he refuses to tell you whether it is accepted or not and 24 hours has lapsed, it is deemed accepted. That's constructive. Oh, let's go here. General. Kung ano ang bill, yun ng acceptance. Kung isang milyon. Kung payable 60 days after sight, payable 60 days after sight. Kung payable in Manila. Pero kapag binago ang bill ay 1 million, nakalagay, accepted for 500,000. The acceptance now is not general. It is qualified. And if you were the holder, what are you going to do? You say, 1 million eh, bakit 500 lang? Ay di pumalag ka, is it not? You did not agree to the qualified acceptance. Biro mo, 1 million to 500. Ay, syempre, hindi ka mag-agree. So what are you going to do? You have to treat the bill as dishonored. And charge the person secondarily liable this time because you considered it as dishonor. But suppose you said, okay na lang ang 500,000 dahil maliit naman pangangailangan ko, hindi na 1 million. So you agreed. When you agreed to the qualified acceptance, all the parties secondarily liable, including the drawer, they are discharged from liability because they are no longer parts of the original contract. There was novation. Hindi na sila sa kasali sa kontratang 1 million. Bago ng kontrata, hindi na sila kasama. 500,000, novation. Biro mo yan. Civil code. Oh, pero tingnan nyo lang yan. Okay. So, presentment for payment. O, ganun din. If it is paid, anong effect? Discharge. If it is not paid, what do you call it? If it is not paid, what do you call the act? Dishonor. Okay? Dishonor by non-payment. What are you going to do? Maybe you do this also. If it is a foreign bill, make a protest. If it is an inland bill, you make a notice of dishonor. So these are the basic things we have to know. You will notice, you will not find presentment for acceptance in a promissory note. A promissory note is not to be accepted, it is to be paid. But a bill of exchange may be presented for acceptance only when section 143 applies. You don't have to waste your time a little longer on negotiable instruments, not too much. Now, when you are given a topic on analysis on whether an instrument is negotiable or not, let us write something here. You are going to look first at that portion that talks about the payee. Because many questions in the bar concentrate on the payee, but it is not noticed by the examinee. Let me give you an example. You tell me if it is 3:15. Ah. Okay. Yes, just 1 minute. 1 minute. Lang. Kasi kung may umabsent na reviewer, pupunta uli ako dito. Okay? Now look. I promise to pay to Mr. Torres 1 million, etc. Okay, lagyan natin ang sign. Baka sabihin nyo, not signed. Okay. M. Kung kayo'y nag-a-analyze yan, kung negotiable or not, ang una nyo titingnan ay, eto, huwag mo nyo lagpasan to. Pag okay ito, saka yung iba. Eh, dito pa lang, mali na. Kaya hindi ka na mag-analyze. It is not negotiable. Next sentence. Under the negotiable instruments law, to be negotiable, among others, it must be payable to bearer or to order. But an instrument payable to a specified person is payable neither to bearer nor to order. Period. You stop. Huwag ka namang overacting ng haba na sagot mo ganito. Under the law, to be negotiable, it must be in writing, unsigned by the maker or drawer. It must contain an unconditional promise to pay some certain and money. It must be payable to order to bearer. It must be so blah blah. Addressed to a drawer, he must mean otherwise indicate that it with reasonable certainty. Ay, ang issue lang naman ay payable to order or to bearer. Kaya pag mahaba, among others, must be payable to order or to bearer. This is not negotiable. This is not payable to order or to bearer. This is payable to a specified person. Sir, paano sir natin malaman kung payable to order or to bearer? Itinan mo Section 9 at Section 8, see? Now look. Okay. Oh. Ano ang forma ng order? Okay. Halimbawa, Willard Riano. Ganitong forma ng order. Pay to the order of Willard Riano. Pay to Willard Riano or his order. Yun ang forma. Eh, sir, kung pay to Willard Riano or order, okay yun. Wala lang his. Bunga lang. See? Pay to the order, to the command of Willard Riano. Okay lang yun. Kasi you do not need the language of this act as long as you use equivalent words. That's Section 10. Okay? Oh. Ang mahirap na forma ay ang bearer. Dahil marami. Oh, look at this. Sandali lang class, ha? Pakisabi kong 320. Pakisabi kong 320. Look. Yan. Pay to... Kasi dito nang gagaling ang bar kadalasan. Pay to bearer. Yan. Payable to bearer yan. Because it is expressed to be so payable. An instrument is payable to bearer when it is expressed to be so payable. Meaning, it is payable to bearer kung sinabi nang payable to bearer. E anong say mo? Sinabi ba ang payable to bearer? Ay, bearer yan. Oh, next. Next. When it is payable to a specified person or bearer. Tandaan nyo, a specified person or bearer. Oh, pay to Jose. What's the name of the guy there? Torres or bearer. Yan. Payable to a specified person or bearer. Bearer. Pero hindi pwedeng pay to bearer Jose Torres. Not negotiable. Ang bearer doon ay description lang ni Jose. Para mong sinabing pay to poging Jose Torres. O, di pay to Jose Torres lang yun. Not negotiable. Now, the next one which will be the subject of our case is this. An instrument is payable to bearer when it is payable to the order of a fictitious or non-existing person, and such fact was known to the person making it so payable. Therefore, if it is payable to Superman, that's not negotiable. Kasi kailangan pay to the order by fictitious or non-existing person. Yan ang American jurisprudence interpretation. Pay to the order of Superman. Pay to the order of Maria Makiling. Non-existent. Pay to the order of the King of Manila. Ay, wala namang King of Manila. Pero, ang consensus kung pay to, man, to the King of Manila, hindi. Kasi sabi sa rule to the order of a fictitious person, hindi payable to a fictitious person. Oh. Pero hindi yan ang point ng exam. Ang point ng exam ay ganito. Pwede bang fictitious ang payee kahit tunay siyang tao?
Yes.
Kung ginamit mo ang pangalan niya but you do not intend send him to be the person who will receive payment. As far as you are concerned, he is fictitious. Look, bakit payable to bearer?
Bakit?
Pag order of fictitious. Because a payable to order has to be endorsed plus delivered. Is it not? If fictitious yan, do not expect him to endorse. Because a fictitious or non-existing person cannot sign. Follow me. There is no endorsement. So from that, we will go to a case. Okay?
Yes.